Now can you guess which is the crop which I am going to deal with today? I'm going to deal with today is it belongs to the family Umbelliferae. So okay, it's an umbelliferous member like coriander, dill, or caraway, so or ajwain, so like that. It's commonly called as ummi majus botanically, so popularly known as bishop's weed. You might have heard about it, bishop's weed, but seed size is very very small. So it's also referred as greater ummi. So basically these seed spices are rabi crops, and so is your ummi majus. Most of these crops have been evolved from Mediterranean region, where you can see the typical climate during vegetative growth is slightly cooler, and during reproductive period they need warm dry weather, which is prevalent especially during February, March and April in our country. Okay, from November onwards it's more of course monsoon has come to the cessation by that time, so that's the ideal time when the temperature is low. Most of the seed spices, including ummi majus, they puts up a very good vegetative growth. Okay, so if you delay in sowing, so you will it is at the cost of vegetative growth. So there will be reduced seed yield. So that's why proper sowing time, ideal sowing time, is most important in cultivation of ummi majus. So this is one of the most important plant sources for the group of chemicals called furanocoumarins. There are so many furanocoumarins. The major furanocoumarin is xanthotoxin. Other furanocoumarins includes isopimpenelin and bergapten. Bishop's weed is honey plant. So is honey plant. Though both the herb and seed both can be used. Okay, the herb can be used in a way we use coriander or dill or celery for seasoning purpose. It's slightly aromatic, but for all commercial reasons, the seed is the economic part. What is the fruit in case of umbelliferous members is called? Fruit in all of the umbelliferous plants is botanically called schizocarp or schizocarp sometimes. Or sometimes we may call it as cremocarp as well. So there are two seeds in each of these fruits. So those are called mericarps. Otherwise, seed is the most important one, economically or even medicinal, okay, which is the important source for xanthotoxins, which I have already mentioned, which is the major furanocoumarin. So sometimes in Iran, Egypt and Mediterranean region it's called kella. So coming to the uses, like other seed spices, it's a very good carminative. It aids in digestion, so it can also be used against asthma, because it's slightly pungent and more spicy, so it relieves your bronchial problems or issues, respiratory issues associated. But the predominant use of ummi majus or honey plant is in treating vitiligo. It is what we call tonnu in Kannada or leukoderma in medical terminologies. Okay. We have another skin-related disorder, psoriasis, though it's an introduced crop to India. Okay? You might have heard about Forest Research Institute, Dehradun. Forest Research Institute, Dehradun, because of their efforts through UNESCO, so during 1955, these two crops, of course, one species is ummi majus, honey plant, and the related species of ummi, another one, that is ummi visnaga. So both have been introduced to FRI Dehradun. but it's commercially grown nowadays in Uttar Pradesh, Gujarat, and Tamil Nadu. These are the major growing areas. Of course, in other states also, to some extent, it is grown, but it is not widely popular among the Indians. Okay. It was a very traditional crops, traditional crop in its native, that is Egypt and other Mediterranean countries. So there was one person by name Ibn al-Baythar. Ibn al-Baythar, he has written a book called Al-Mughni al-Kabir. So he described very long back, stating that the patients who swallow an ounce of powdered ami every day, I think 1 ounce is around 28.4 grams, and then exposes himself to the sunlight. So there is no point in taking only the powdered ami majas. After taking it, you have to get yourself exposed to the sunlight. Then only there will be positive reaction taking place. The normal skin was not affected. Okay, if you have a normal skin, there is no problem. So nothing will happen. If you have vitiliginous part, or if there is psoriasis, that particular part of the skin, it swells because of the light and this furanocoumarins present in ami majors and begins to heal. So that's the beauty of this. During 1947, importance of 1947 as far as ami majors is concerned, there is a person called Fahmy, Dr. Fahmy, his co-workers in Cairo, Egypt. There is a school of pharmacy. They were the ones who could able to isolate and characterize some of the furanocoumarins called amoidine, amidine, and bergaptin. In 1955, amoidine, amidine, and bergaptin, they were also called as sorrelins. So they act only in presence of the sunlight. So that's the beauty of this crop. That's in brief about the background of this particular crop, ami majas. It's actually annual only, but if you grow in too cooler climate, or if you grow at a very high altitude, so it behaves as a biennial. Okay. Now coming to the botanical description and the floral biology of this particular crop. Generally, it's an annual umbelliferous herb. Okay. The inflorescence is there in its family name itself. Okay, it's umbel. Okay, so it may grow over a meter's height. So depending on soil, climate, and other factors, it's got a long tap root. It's very important, especially when it is it grows very tall. So to avoid this lodging, so the tap root helps really. So it has got a solid erect stem. So it has got decompound leaves, which are generally light green in color, alternate, pinnately divided. So you can see umbels which are either axillary or terminal in bearing. Sometimes axillary, sometimes terminal, both you can see. Okay. So it's a compound umbel. Umbel flowers are generally white in color. They attract a lot of pollinators as well. Fruit, it's a schizocarp. Schizocarp, it has got two seeds inside. Those are called mericarps. Fruit is, it's ribbed, ellipsoidal in shape, green to greenish brown when immature. So green to greenish brown when immature, reddish brown at maturity. So it changes its color. Okay. The taste is bitter and pungent. So there are two botanical varieties, Ami majus variety, Suttons monoica. These are not two different varieties, Suttons and monoica, not like that. It's a botanical variety, Ami majus variety, Suttons monoica. And one more is Ami majus variety horticulture. Now coming to the soil and climatic conditions. Okay, if you see in the major production areas of these crops, not necessarily it is grown in highly fertile soils. It comes up really well even in marginal soils with low fertility, especially in Rajasthan, Gujarat, those areas where seed spices are traditionally grown, okay, in parts of UP also. But it will not tolerate the waterlogging condition or excess moisture, okay. It prefers well-drained, loamy soils. Hardy crop thrives relatively well on poor and degraded soils. Only condition is you should have very good drainage, okay. As far as climatic requirement is concerned, already I mentioned it's a winter annual. As far as seed is concerned, when you are growing Ummi Majus as a seed crop, the season is very, very important. So we grow generally as a rabi crop. But if you are interested in herb like coriander, so any part of the year you can do that. Okay. So at early stages of its growth, it requires mild, cool climate. Towards maturity, dry weather, warm and dry weather is ideal. Okay. So, just to say, the other conditions which will not support these crops are the soil salinity. If the soil is saline, alkaline, or waterlogged, into propagation. Yeah, it is propagated through seeds only. Okay. There are two kinds of using the seeds as propagules. One is you can directly sow, either broadcast or line sow, or you can raise a nursery and then transplant also. You can appreciate the difference in the seed rate, okay, between transplanting and direct sowing. See, for transplanting, only 1.5 to 2 kg seed per hectare is sufficient, whereas around 12 kg is required for direct sowing. Seeds generally take 10 to 12 days to germinate. So if you can soak a day prior to sowing, so will hasten the process of germination by 3 to 4 days. Based on the studies conducted in northern India, so the ideal time for sowing was 3rd week of October, the 1st week of November. So August is too early. The sowing time is very critical to get higher seed yield. Okay, spacing, you can follow either 45 by centimeter by 45 centimeter between rows and between plants, or you can also follow 45 by 60 or 60 by 45 with, or 30 by 30. If you follow very close spacing, then you see there is a considerable damage caused by trampling while harvesting. So as far as intercultivation is concerned, yes, you need at least one or two hoeings after sowing, depending on the weed growth, especially from November to January, this 3 months. If winter rain fails, irrigation is essential during November to January, but also during March to April, that is the maturation, seed development and maturation time for this crop. So at that time also, there should not be a dearth for water. 15 to 20 days interval or two irrigations during seed development definitely matters a lot for this particular crop. So coming to the nutrition, so I've already mentioned, irrespective of crop, you have to follow integrated nutrient management based on the soil analysis. Generally, the phosphorus and potassium, they mainly act on growth, that is vegetative growth of this particular plant. Whereas the furanocoumarins, the accumulation of these coumarins like xanthotoxin, bergoptin, isopimpinelin, or any other furanocoumarins for that matter, depends mainly on nitrogenous fertilization. Please underline. So this is a very important aspect. The bergoptin and xanthotoxin, two furanocoumarins, their accumulation in addition to nitrogen fertilization also depends on temperature and day length. Therefore, they have arrived at a desired ratio to maximize the production of furanocoumarins. So 2:1:1.7 means if you are giving 2 kg nitrogen,
1 kg phosphorus and 1.7 kg potassium. In this ratio you have to give. Okay. Generally 80 kg nitrogen per hectare is preferred for this particular crop. And there is one more dosage, one more recommendation from AACRP, that is 100 kg N, 115 kg P2O5 and 30 kg K2O is also reported. Okay. So coming to the pests and diseases, not much pests and diseases have been reported. There is one virus which is reported for the first time in India, which is called bright yellow mosaic virus. The only option is to rogue out the infected plants at early stage, and then you have to manage the vector through systemic insecticides or neem based insecticides, and also you can follow a integrated pest management. So other than that, there are some storage pathogens. You might have heard about Aspergillus. So there is one species of Aspergillus called Aspergillus otreus, which causes heavy damage to the xanthotoxin, so which is very important as far as medicinal potency of this this particular plant is concerned. During the first month of storage, so there will be a serious reduction in xanthotoxin if it is infected by the fungi, storage fungi, Aspergillus ochraceus. Okay. So during later stages, okay, another Aspergillus, that is Aspergillus niger, Aspergillus flavus, and Fusarium oxysporum also sometimes, they also cause a slight damage second and third month of storage. And thereafter, there is a drastic reduction in xanthotoxin content. Coming back to the harvesting of this particular crop, so generally, umbels, whether it is you have primary and secondary umbels, sometimes tertiary umbels also you can find, they do not mature simultaneously. That's the big problem. So, which demands selective harvesting of umbels based on their maturity. Since umbels do not mature simultaneously, you have to harvest the crop in stages only. So primary umbels will mature fast. If you delay the harvesting, so there will be seed shattering. So what will happen if you harvest everything at once? So if you harvest at once, problem is you have the seeds of varying maturity. You have immature, you have mature, you have over mature seeds. So that's the problem. Therefore, you have to harvest selectively. Generally, three harvests. First, you will harvest the primary umbels. Then you will harvest the secondary umbels. And third time, you will harvest the whole crop, and then you will go for threshing. So because you have to maximize the labor use efficiency also. So don't delay the harvesting of primary umbels, by which you are going to lose a lot of seeds through the process of shattering, or you are not supposed to give narrow spacing also, which leads to a lot of trampling during harvesting. Synchronize the maturity of umbels, so you can think of using a growth regulator called Planofix, which contain naphthalene acetic acid. It's basically an auxin. At a very low concentration you have to use 5 ppm at flower initiation and fruit formation stage. So this is very critical, and this is a very important intervention also to reduce the shattering losses, and also to synchronize the maturity of a primary, secondary, and even then you cannot ensure 100% uniform maturity, but nevertheless, so around 70 to 80% of the umbels, the fruits will be maturing simultaneously, thereby reducing the shattering losses and increases the yield by around 40 to 50%. So generally the amimages flowers during the beginning of the year, that is January, February, okay? Towards the end of the winter months. Okay? The fruiting you can see in March, so around 6-7 months is required, almost around 6 to 7 months is the crop duration, so you can harvest. Okay, so you see the xanthotoxin content also varies depending on the maturity of the seeds. Say for example, if you have harvested the seeds in mature green stage, so the xanthotoxin will be around 0.72%. So So if it is immature green stage, the xanthotoxin is 1%. If it is mature brown stage, it is less, see 0.4%. To strike a balance, generally mature green stage is preferred. So you have to harvest the umbels at mature green stage so that you will get maximum seeded and the optimum xanthotoxin content. You can get around 900 to 1200 kg seeds per hectare as the yield. This is the overview of Ammimajus. In vitiligo or leucoderma, these furanocoumarins also possess some other important properties, like they are bactericidal, fungicidal, herbicidal, larvicidal, molluscicidal, nematicidal, ovicidal and viricidal activities. If you have any questions, you are free to ask. Thank you.